Betaflight 4.5 brings some new and interesting features. So a lot of people have been asking me whether the PIDtoolbox tuning process works the same. Well, the short answer is yes. While there are a lot of improvements to this firmware, there really aren't any significant changes to the PID or filter systems, with the exception of RPM filter weights, to my knowledge. But over the years, I've modified the steps to some degree, and my process doesn't always follow the same protocol as other popular YouTubers out there. Now, maybe the different approaches would ultimately converge on the same settings, but this will depend on the fine details that not everybody understands and often misinterprets. So I'm going to step you through the workflow that I've refined over the past couple of years since I started my PID tuning service. To date, I've tuned around 546 drones, not including my own fleet. And over that time, I've learned quite a few things. Certainly the bulk of this has been heavy lift drones carrying cinema cameras, but in principle, it's the same. So what's the first thing I do? Nowadays, I request the first log file to be a simple steady hover with current settings, whatever settings you have on there generally. Why do I do this? Well, for a number of reasons. One, when you're helping people, they're going to come from very different backgrounds and skill levels, and they're going to come with different drone sizes and varying issues, etc. So there's just too many variables at the front end. You simply don't know the state of the rig until you see a simple log file. And the last thing you want to do is tell a client with a 13-inch lifter carrying a gimbal to do a 0 to 100% throttle ramp. It's just not practical. I should add here, though, at some point it's obvious that you want to fly the rig in a more aggressive way and potentially do full throttle ramps, etc. But that's something that can be done at the last stage as well. So once you know the drone is safe and it's tuned really well, then you can always add that to the last of the steps, right? The second reason we do a steady hover is because 99% of major issues are detectable in this very simple log file if you know what to look for. And this is something that I've learned over the years. In most cases, you don't need a ripping flight to see the main issues. People will usually describe an issue they experienced during flight, and in most cases, there are signatures of that issue in the simplest of log files. Now, if they already have a log file, that's great, but usually there's something missing. Either they're not logging pre-filtered gyro or the log rate's too low, etc. So maybe in part I do this because I deal mostly with lifters, but there are other reasons as well. 3. A hover test is replicable. This means if we want to see the effect of any changes on the power spectrum, we can be confident that the differences we see are due to our change and not a flight difference, and we have a good benchmark going forward. 4. It's an ideal method for detecting basic electrical or gyro issues and distinguishing motor vibration from electrical noise. In part because electrical issues manifest as elevated broadband noise that you can see when hovering. And when you're doing a steady hover, RPM is constant, so the motor noise manifests as discrete peaks in the time-collapsed 2D power spectrum. And it manifests as straight bands in the frequency by time spectrogram. So it's just really easy to distinguish these. So you know the noise floor you see is then not due to aggressive flying, which will in itself elevate broadband noise. And this last point is really the crux of why most drones have issues. It really is a quality control issue, and I can tell you with some confidence that most bind and fly CineWhoops, for example, that use all-in-one flight controllers, have gyro and electrical issues. I've seen clients get up to 3 or more replacement boards from popular drone shops. Usually they replace the boards for free, so they clearly know this is an issue, but they keep selling it anyway. For newcomers to the hobby, they might simply not realize this is an issue, and then they find themselves combing the black box forums asking for PID settings that they think is going to solve their issue. Sometimes there are mechanical, ESC, and software fixes that help right at the front end, and honestly, this is arguably the most important factor behind a good flying rig. And we've not even made it yet to step one in PID tuning. Okay, once we've solved the issues at the front end, I typically make a tentative filter recommendation. Now you might say, how can you assess filters without doing a full flight across the full extent of the throttle? Now there's some truth to this, but there's always a lot that we can do. First of all, once we start the PID tuning wobble tests, we get for free great estimates of filter delay around hover throttle. which is where filter delay will be greatest, but we also can get a decent assessment of motor noise as the wobbling pushes the motors between 10 to 50 or 60% output multiple times during a test. So we do get a good sense of the effectiveness of the filter setup over this motor range. It is more informative than you think, especially for lifters. Okay, so then I generally continue to fine-tune filters in parallel with PID tuning. So you'll often see in different approaches to tuning that people say we first want to set our filters. But see, the problem with that concept is that as you PID tune, you're going to change the state of the gyro and the D-term. And so why wouldn't you continue to look at the noise profile? Because in every test, we get valuable data. So why wouldn't you continually assess the state of the gyro and D-term as we manipulate the PIDs? Most motor noise and resonance issues will reveal themselves throughout this process. I'm always assessing how this is changing, and I make adjustments accordingly. And any adjustments we make will give us a good sense of the filter delay in the worst case scenario, because the dynamic filters will be at their lowest point, showing the worst case filter delay estimates because the tests are all done at low throttle. So now when I analyze noise profiles, what I want to see is only motor vibration. Only motor vibration. Anything else doesn't belong there. I always say as long as we fly drones with spinning motors, props, it's the one thing that we can count on is motor vibration. And this vibration is by its nature narrow band, right? So if everything is electrically sound, there should be nothing else. No broadband noise. This is a really important point that most people just don't think about. I see posts all the time saying, how do we filter out the noise? Well, first, define noise. And then we can decide which Betaflight filter is optimal to address it. But if you think about it, if really our drones should only be showing motor noise, conceptually, any flight firmware that doesn't utilize notch filters is kind of missing the point, right? So let's break it down for a minute. There are basically two types of filters that all flight firmwares use. It's either low pass, which filters a wide range of frequencies with a small amount of attenuation, relatively speaking, or notch filters. And notch filters are narrow band. In other words, they focus on specific frequencies and they cut the frequencies really sharply. So they have a really strong amount of attenuation. So if you think about it, if under the ideal conditions, if drones only produce motor vibration, which is what they should only produce, if you've got a solid frame and no electrical issues, then the only thing you really need is RPM filters. So, I mean, this is really the beauty and at the heart of what makes Betaflight the best, right? It's the best out there. So when you think about it, then we have in Betaflight, we have low pass filters and we have notch filters. Now you might say, well, we have RPM filters and we have dynamic notches and we have notches, but make no mistake, they're all notch filters and they're actually all using the same general code to generate those notches, right? The only difference between RPM and dynamic notches is the way in which it centers those notches, okay? So you can see where I'm going with this. So the thing is, you do need some low pass filtering because there will always be a little bit of broadband noise, even in the best case scenario. And the D-term will always amplify that noise. So utilizing the filters properly, you can really lower the filter delay and improve flight performance dramatically. Okay, there's a whole lot more I could say about filters, but for now I'm going to leave it at that because I think it can be a really complicated topic. I think it's deserving of its own video. So once we've optimized the filters, or at least tentatively optimized them for a basic steady hover, what we're going to do is we're going to move into PID tuning. So most of this remains the same as my earlier videos, and I'll drop a link to that up here. This process is relatively straightforward. Most people can follow it, but you do want to get the starting settings right. For non-Betaflight users, there's also a PID slider tool in PIDtoolbox, and I'm constantly refining this to make it a little bit more applicable to the different firmwares. So now we have to talk about angle mode, since it is the recommended mode for basement tuning wobble tests. Betaflight 4.5 has made massive changes to angle and horizon modes. just know that the default angle setting should work fine, but it will be affected by your rates, specifically your rate curve. In the past, this was not the case. So if angle mode feels too soft, making a linear rate curve should help. But I'll have more to say about this in a later video. We then zero out the dynamic damping slider and lower the iTerm drift wobble slider to about 0.1 or 0.2. It's useful to have some iTerm to counter drift during tests. Now we no longer need to zero out feed forward on the PID tab because it will not be active when using angle mode, which has its own feed forward and has no effect on PID tuning. It's also worth noting here that I typically make some minor adjustment to the master multiplier slider from the start. So for example, some 3 to 5 inch rigs are already overtuned at a default master multiplier of 1.0. In contrast, some rigs are way undertuned at this default. So I make some adjustment based on experience, knowledge of the power to weight, and the rotational inertia in particular. The same is true for where I start the damping slider. So you don't want to have to do a million tests. So having some experience and knowledge with where to start the damping tests can make the process quicker. I've also seen cases where you're already adequately dampened at, the, say, the 1.0 mark of the damping slider. And I see people actually stepping it up from 1.0 to 1.2 to 1.4, etc. And they're saying, well, I don't see any difference in the step response. And that's because you've already started too high. So some of this comes from experience, but you have to know a little bit about the drone you're working with and where to expect the damping and the master should be. So the order of operations in terms of the sliders. So this is another thing that people do differently. Step one, I determine the optimal P to D ratio first using the damping slider and holding all the others constant. I just like to do it that way, and I think it makes a lot more sense than, say, shifting the PI slider, because unless you have iTerm completely dropped out, you're going to be also moving the iTerm in that case. Okay, so then two, then I assess the roll to pitch latency. I go down here to the pitch tracking and pitch damping slider, and I make some adjustment as needed. How do I do this? So I'm basically assessing the latency of roll to pitch as I'm doing these tests. If it's only a minor difference of, say, a millisecond, I usually just leave it. But if you see pitch has a lot more lag, then I'll make that adjustment. And usually pitch does lag behind quite a bit depending on the distribution of weight across the pitch axis. So the frame geometry is going to matter quite a bit here. Often people basically ignore this. But you have to know when it's worth going further as well. Sometimes there's simply too much rotational inertia on the pitch axis, making it impossible to really optimize pitch without increasing the overall pitch gains too much. So you just have to know when to stop there. But really, it's one of those things that I think frame developers should really think about. But oftentimes, the development of the frame doesn't even consider rotational inertia, which is kind of a shock to me. Three, I then increase the master multiplier until we near a latency plateau using both the step response latency estimate and the cross-correlation lag measure, which can be found in the spectral analyzer. Or we begin to see some undesirable things, including excessive D-term noise or indications of PID feedback oscillation. These are not always simple to detect, and I could spend an entire video on this topic alone. Often this is where people make the biggest mistake and misinterpret the data, and resulting in either too high or too low master multiplier gains. So you had to be really careful here. Now the last two parameters are iTerm, the drift wobble slider, and feed forward, the stick response slider. More often than not, I don't fine tune these factors to any extent these days, in part because the tuning window is wide and a range of values will work. And I know from experience what values will work well, but it depends on the rig that I'm tuning. The main value of feed forward from my perspective is essentially to lower the end-to-end latency. We can have a whole conversation about tracking, but for another time. For lifters, I recommend feed forward anywhere between 0.5 and 1.0, which will typically reduce response latency by roughly 6 to 12 milliseconds. But using Crossfire 50 Hz, which most people flying lifters still use, If you set feed forward greater than 1.0, you will begin to disrupt the optimal P to D ratio. So last is iTerm, and I always say iTerm has a very wide tuning window. You can use the PTB step response tool for this, and in that case, you traditionally test iTerm before feed forward. But now with Betaflight 4.5, setting feed forward in the PID tab will have no effect when wobbling in angle mode anyway. So any assessment of iTerm using the PID step response in angle mode will not take into account how the error gap will be subsequently reduced when feed forward is added and you're flying in normal rate mode. In other words, when error is reduced, iTerm cannot accumulate. That is, it can't go up very easily. Hence, one would continue increasing iTerm with no side effects if feed forward is doing its job. So in a sense, they go hand in hand, but you see the conundrum here. So I'm going to leave this for the moment. It requires the tuner to know and understand the fundamentals of PIDs. But I've discussed this in a past video, so I think I'll just link that here as well. So let me know what you think in the comments, and don't forget to like and subscribe if you want to see more content like this.